Hello everyone, welcome to MBBS classes. Myself Dr. Hanifa. Today in this video I'll be talking on adenoids. So we know that the term adenoid is used for the hyperplasia of this nasopharyngeal or the pharyngeal tonsils and when they produce symptoms. So we have seen from our anatomy classes on the adenoids and the Waldeyer's ring that the adenoid is one of the component of the Waldeyer's ring. So this the components, if we see here, of the Waldeyer's ring are the nasopharyngeal tonsil, tubal tonsils. These two are situated in the nasopharynx. This is the palatine tonsils present bilaterally, and the last is the lingual tonsils. These two are situated in the oropharynx. This nasopharyngeal tonsil is situated in the nasopharynx at the junction of roof and the posterior wall of the nasopharynx, and when they become significantly big and produce symptoms, we use the term adenoids. This adenoid term was coined by Wilhelm Meyer. This adenoid is present at birth. It shows the physiological enlargement up to the age of 6 years, and after that it atrophies. The function of the adenoid and specifically these lymphoid tissues is related to the immunity. It is seen that they produce antibodies and they play an important role in the development of immunological memory in the younger children. How do they present? The adenoids, they are present in the nasopharynx and it is present since birth, but not all the children, they produce the symptoms. It is seen that the symptom is related to the relative ratio between the size of the adenoids and the nasopharyngeal space. So a child may present as nasal symptoms. So under the nasal symptoms, the most common being the chronic nasal obstruction, due to which the child will have a problem of mouth breathing. Then they may also give a problem with the airway obstruction or with the obstructive sleep apnea. Because of these nasal obstructions, sometimes the child may have difficulty with the feeding or while sleeping also. Due to the obstruction at the level of the nasopharynx, when it becomes infected or whenever there is an associated problem of the biofilm, whenever there is a layer of the discharge over the adenoids, it could be the reason for the runny nose. Then the other symptoms being the snoring, hyponasal speech or the voice, and it can be a cause of the chronic sinusitis. Mostly it is seen that the chronic maxillary sinusitis is commonly associated with the adenoids. The reason is due to the persistence of the nasal discharge and due to the associated infection. Then there may be ear symptoms like history of recurrent otitis media and otitis media with effusion. There may be impairment of the function of the eustachian tube, and this could result in the hearing loss. The type of hearing loss is usually conductive hearing loss. The ear symptom is a secondary effect because it can be due to the mass effect of the adenoid when it blocks the eustachian tube opening, which is present in the nasopharynx. Second is whenever there is associated adenoiditis, that means infection of the adenoids, then there may be retrograde spread of infection via the eustachian tube to the middle ear. Then the other clinical presentation of adenoid can be the changes in the craniofacial morphology. It is seen that the children with the significant obstruction, they have maxillary deformity and dental malalignment. Among the other clinical manifestations of the adenoid, since it is associated with the nasal obstruction, it can interfere with the swallowing. So the child may have dysphagia problem because of the disturbed sleep, snoring, nose obstruction, airway obstruction. The child will have disturbed sleep. Then it is seen that the group of children may have aneurysis, and if the symptoms they persist and if it is not corrected, it can lead to disturbance of growth and in very few cases failure to thrive also. Among the general symptoms, these group of patients with the significant obstruction or significant nasal obstruction due to the enlarged adenoids, we get typical characteristic of the face, which is called adenoid faces. So the components of the adenoid faces is the child will have an elongated face with a dull expression and an open mouth. It is seen that because of the frequent mouth breathing, they develop prominent and crowded upper teeth and hitched up upper lip. Then they will have a pinched up nose. The reason of pinched up nose is that they are not breathing through the nose, rather than they are breathing from the mouth. And since they are not breathing up through the nose, there is a disuse atrophy of the Allanese muscle. Moreover, it is seen that the child will have a high arched palate, and this high arched palate, it leads to the dental deformity and the maxillary deformity. So when a child is presenting to you with a nasal obstruction, mouth breathing problem, hearing difficulty, then what are the investigations which needs to be done? First of all, the most important being the nasal endoscopy. The reason being, it gives a proper visualization of the size of the adenoids, and we can also do the clinical grading of the adenoid size as per the classification given by Clemens et al. Moreover, the gold standard is that it should be done before adenoidectomy. That is, the preoperative assessment is recommended, and we must do the nasal endoscopy in the children whenever possible. So if you see here, this is an endoscopic picture. This is the left side of the nasal cavity. This is the nasal septum, and this is the inferior turbinate. And we know that the adenoid is situated, but here we cannot see the tubal opening. And if you see here, this is an adenoid mass, which is occluding almost 2/3 of the nasopharynx. Now let's see the grading system given by the Clemens et al. So this is just a clinical grading, which is approximate grading, which is done by the clinician while doing the nasal endoscopy. So we call it a grade 1 adenoid when the adenoid is filling up 1/3 of the vertical portion of the quana. So this is the quana, or the posterior nasal aperture. Grade 2 is when it fills up from 1/3 to 2/3 of the quana. Grade 3 is when it fills up from 2/3 to near complete obstruction of the quana. You can see here, we can call it grade 3 adenoid hypertrophy. And grade 4 is complete quanal obstruction. Next is, since the adenoid invariably it causes ear symptoms, so we must always examine the ear. Even when they are not complaining of ear symptoms, also ear examination is must. So there are, I have given certain clinical pictures of the patients with the problem secondary to the adenoid. So since adenoid can cause recurrent attacks of acute otitis media, so this is how tympanic membrane looks in a case of acute otitis media. So if you see here, the tympanic membrane is congested, it is bulged, and it is, you can see here in the posterior inferior quadrant, it is bulging is there. Then sometimes it can also lead to fluid in the middle ear. So if you see here, when there are certain air bubbles and the fluid in the middle ear, and in cases of chronic obstruction of the eustachian tube, it can also present as retraction of the tympanic membrane or dull tympanic membrane. So you may get different type of clinical findings in the ear, and which may not be same in all the children. So whenever patients, family member or the guardian, they are complaining that the child is not hearing properly along with the nasal obstruction, in the typical age group, the affected is from the 4 to 8 years of age. This is the peak age group. So in these cases, we must do the audiological investigations. So the audiological test which is advised in case of adenoid is the pure tone audiometry and the tympanometry. So you can see here, this is an audiogram showing the conductive hearing loss. If you see here, this is the bone conduction curve, and this is the ear conduction curve, and this is the gap, ear bone gap is more than 10 decibel, and this is a pure tone audiogram showing the conductive type of hearing loss. In cases of adenoids, when we do the tympanometry, typically we get a B type of tympanogram. If you see here, this is a B type of tympanogram. Why it is B type? Because the tympanogram is flat in shape. If you see here, and there is no pressure peak. If you see here, the peak is NP, that means no pressure peak. So these are the two typical findings we get in a case of adenoids. Next is, we must ask for the X-ray of the nasopharynx lateral view to see the extent of the size of the nasopharynx and how much it is compromised. So if you see here, I have given two X-rays. One is, this is the normal, and this is the showing the adenoids in the nasopharynx. If you see here, this is the nasopharyngeal air column in the normal. That means this adenoid is not compromising the nasopharyngeal airway. But if you see here, this adenoid is significantly enlarged and it is causing the significant obstruction of the nasopharyngeal air column. But the disadvantage of X-ray nasopharynx is that it does not give the accurate correlation of the adenoid size, but it must be done for the documentation purpose. So when the patient, they are having the symptoms are marked, the adenoidectomy has to be done. Now let's see what are the indications of the adenoidectomy. So adenoidectomy, when a patient is having chronic adenoid hypertrophy and when it is causing obstructive sleep apnea, severe nasal obstruction, then associated craniofacial morphology problems like maxillary deformity, dentition problems, and when the child is having excessive snoring problems. So these symptoms, they suggest that the size of the adenoid is significantly enlarged. When there is chronic adenoiditis, that means whenever when the child is having infection of the adenoids. So in these cases, the patient will have history of nasal discharge and history of chronic sinusitis. Then adenoidectomy is also done in children above 3 years of age who require repeated grommet insertion. Grommet insertion, as you know, it is done for the treatment of the otitis media with effusion. Sometimes the adenoidectomy is also done along with the primary grommet placement in cases with the additional nasal obstruction. And these nasal obstruction is always confirmed by doing nasopharyngoscopy and by doing the X-ray nasopharynx. So we have seen the indications of the adenoidectomy, but sometimes the adenoidectomy may have to be combined with the tonsillectomy. That means in some of the children, the adenoid along with the tonsils may be enlarged and it could be the cause of the obstructive sleep apnea. In those cases, the adenoid must be removed first and then it is followed by the tonsillectomy. There are certain contraindications which are specific for the adenoidectomy. It should not be done when a child is having active upper respiratory tract infection, when a child is having a history of bleeding disorders, and whenever there is a occult submucous cleft palate, because they are prone to develop velopharyngeal insufficiency. So this is a surgery which is done under general anesthesia. So there are various techniques. It can be done by using a classical cold steel instruments. Nowadays it is done by using the coablation and also by using the micro debrider. The advantage of doing the adenoidectomy by coablation and micro debrider is that it reduces the timing of surgery and also it reduces the amount of bleeding, and moreover the adenoid can be removed precisely under the endoscopic guidance. Now let's see the complications of the adenoidectomy. So the complications, the most common complication being the postoperative hemorrhage. It can be immediate when the bleeding occurs within the 24 hours of surgery, and the bleeding can be delayed when it appears after 24 hours. Then it's the next complication being the trauma. So there could be the trauma to the tooth, soft palate, lips while placing the instruments, and there could be the injury to the eustachian tube because we are operating in the same nasopharyngeal area. Then the next complication which is of concern is the postoperative airway obstruction. The reason of postoperative airway obstruction could be the edema of the tongue, nasopharynx and the palate. There could be the dislodgement of nasopharyngeal blood clot into the larynx, or if there is a retained swab, which is usually the swab is placed in the nasopharynx after adenoidectomy for the hemostasis. So if it is forgotten, if it is retained, and if it dislodges into the airway, it could be the cause of postoperative airway obstruction. Then the another complication which is specific for the adenoidectomy is the velopharyngeal insufficiency, and nasopharyngeal stenosis can also occur when there is extensive removal of the adenoidectomy with the injury to the underlying musculature. It can lead to stenosis due to the scarring of the tissues. Sometimes in very rare cases, it can also affect the cervical spine. It can also lead to atlantoaxial subluxation. This syndrome is called the Griesel's syndrome. With this, I come to an end of this video. Thank you for watching this video.